get the walkthrough. And so we have the copy with the changes. I wasn't sure the clean copy, is that still at the proofers?
Yes.
Okay, all right. Just wait for Tom to get back and... Right, so committee and others looking at draft 8.1 with shading to show the changes from the bill is introduced, right?
All the changes together show that, exactly. All the colors. The gray changes show the ones that have been made between the previous draft and the one right now.
Okay.
But, yeah, they've been sort of staggered by color. And if you looked at all of them together, they show the bill, changes to the bill from the language that was in the version that was introduced, exactly.
Right. And, Kimmy, thank you for yesterday. I thought it was very helpful to be able to take the time and really go through section by section and understand where folks are coming from. Okay, and so Eric, right now it has me and Martin, but you were mentioning that the final doesn't become, did you say,
Yeah, the bill is formally in the committee.
Right.
So when to come out, it's going to be, assuming that it does, it would be a committee amendment, a committee proposal. So a majority of the committee votes for that amendment, then it would be a committee amendment. Phrased now as a strike-all. So that strikes everything that was in the bill as introduced, starts from scratch in terms of language, which is pretty common, right, the bills that are in here. But up until now, it has been...
proposed amendments from the two of us.
Exactly.
Right. So, do folks understand that process or...?
A proposed committee amendment, and the House floor decides, first of all, do they accept the proposal's amendment, and then do they accept the bill as amended?
And if they vote no on the floor, then they go back to voting on the bill without...
I think so. That's a good question. I'm not positive how that works.
On the amendment.
Yeah. I think that's right. Yeah.
All right, great. So, Eric, walk us through. Thank you.
Yeah. So, as I mentioned earlier, we've moved from the most recent color is gray. So the changes that are, I'll focus us on the changes that have been made between the previous draft and this one, and they are identified by gray highlighting. So you see, for just as an example, nothing to look at in section one, the default proceed because the highlighting is yellow and blue, still remaining at the 30-day proposed default proceed, no changes there. So you move on from there to the relief and abuse order section. You see in the entirety of section three is struck through. This was the language that created a new criminal offense for a person impeding a public officer, and you see that's the new language was lines 8 through 13, subsection B there. It had created a new criminal offense for being present at a location where a search and seizure was going on or removal of a firearm pursuant to a relief from abuse order. And if you refuse to obey the instructions of a law enforcement officer to ensure safe removal of firearms or protect safety, that was a new two-year misdemeanor. So the proposal was to create this two-year misdemeanor for a person being in that location, and this new draft strikes that provision completely.
Based on testimony that you heard from the and committee's concern about that it could really bring in people who shouldn't be in the local. It was vague, it was confusing in a constitutional theory of state void for vision.
Right, right. Everyone okay to move on from there? So that section is gone. Then you move on to, this is section 1103, which is the final relief from abuse order stage, final RFAs. The contents of the order itself are very similar, but you'll see that there are some changes when it gets down to relinquishment. Or this is the issue that's been discussed. Is the relief from abuse order going to order relinquishment of firearms? And there have been... the committee's gone through several iterations of under what circumstances the relinquishment would be ordered. So, if you look at subdivision 4 there, this is if the order does require relinquishment, because remember, it won't always. it's depending on what sort of evidence has been presented. But if it does, then these provisions have to be included in the order. So room numeral one there, you'll see that it's sort of a different phrasing of that sentence that we discussed last time I was in here, just to make it more clear that the information available to the court is what's got to be in this initial order for relinquishment. And it's because there's been some confusion about, well, does available information, does that really give the court enough direction to be clear that you're not asking the court to go outside whatever information it has, it's just whatever information is available to the court at that time. So that's the change made on line 18. Now, you see some new language, partially new language here in Roman numeral 2. I'm just going to skip down real quick so you can see that part of it is just moved. The second, actually, it was originally in the emergency order only. I'm just going to really quick skip down. If you can look up back on the wall if you want to. But if you look down on page 10, lines 9 through 11, in the previous version you looked at, the emergency order had to include some information letting the defendant know that third-party storage of firearms is not permitted unless the court has made these findings that are in Title 20. That's this existing law that governs how firearms are stored when they're seized pursuant to an RFA. And there's certain findings the court has to make, because ordinarily the firearm would be stored, could be stored at a law enforcement agency, cooperating law enforcement agency, but a person can get a third person who they know who could safely store the firearms. That is an option, but the court has to make these findings about safety. So this is just articulating that providing notice to the defendant that you can do third-party storage, but the court has to make these findings first. So it's struck here, but it's not removed from the bill. It's just moved elsewhere. And so one of the
real quick question:
yeah,
that's still, you still have that language, but slightly modified in the emergency relief on page 9. Is that right?
I was just going back to that. Exactly. Okay. Okay. Right. Yeah. I was just pointing out that it's struck here, but not struck from the bill. Just moved elsewhere, as you were getting at. So yeah, I modified the language slightly because I think it's really part of the same piece of information that the defendant's getting. It's all related to this existing law in Title 20 that sets forth how it is that firearms are stored once they get seized, and that's already existing. And both these issues were related to that. So you see lines 20 through 21 on page 6 and lines 1 through 2 on page 7 covers both of these things. So if the order requires relinquishment, again, this is about information that has to be provided to the defendant. First thing it has to let the defendant know is that what are the provisions of Title 20, Section 2307, regarding where the defendant is permitted to relinquish firearms. In other words, let the defendant know that you have these options. Law enforcement agency, cooperating law enforcement agency can store them. There's a second option I'm not remembering for some reason, but the third option is private storage by a third person who has to make some affirmations to the court that it's going to be safely stored by that person. If they can do that, then you have this third-party storage option. So these options have to be provided to the defendant. They have to let them know, hey, because if you think about it, at the time of relinquishment, it makes some sense to let the defendant know these are your options for storage. Here's how it could be stored. But, and this is a slight tweak to the language I just pointed out that was struck in one place, moved to here. But to include notice, this is lines 1 and 2, page 7, include notice that third-party storage is not permitted unless the court has made the findings required by Title 20. I think the point there is, you know, you want to let the defendant know you have these options, but make sure the defendant also knows that third-party storage requires some court findings before it can go forward.
Eric, I have a question. I'm sorry if you've already covered it.
Yeah.
So at the top of page 6, line 2, where it says the court order shall, if there is evidence that the defendant possesses, owns, or controls firearms, require the immediate relinquishment. But then there's also the other situation down on line 17 where it says if the order requires relinquishment of firearms. So
right.
Will all orders require the relinquishment of firearms? Because it seems implied in 17, line 17, that there are situations in which the orders wouldn't require relinquishment.
That's right.
If they didn't own firearms.
If they didn't own firearms. Mm.
Right. If there is no evidence, in that line 3 you were just pointing out, if there isn't evidence that the defendant possesses those or controls, then I think the idea is there's no reason to order relinquishment.
Right. Okay. Right. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. So this is another provision of information providing to the defendant during the order if relinquishment is required. No changes to the language from the previous draft that requires defendant to relinquish firearms. So there's a specific, if the order requires relinquishment, to actually let the defendant know that you have to turn them over, and as well provide law enforcement with some information about the firearms. This is lines 5 through 11. Remember, this is talking about the location, production of keys, combination of locks, et cetera. And there's some new language there saying that, so you provide this information unless firearms are turned over without requiring law enforcement access to such locations. I think the idea there is if they turn them over voluntarily, essentially, there's no reason for the defendant to also have to produce location information, combination of locks, that sort of thing.
So just really quickly, because that language we didn't have a chance to look at yesterday when we were discussing this, but I worked on that later to try to address, unfortunately Matt, not with us any longer, but to address the concerns that Matt was raising, and this sought to address the concerns that, this addresses the concerns that Matt had.
Just not here.
Representative Creever. Ex-representative, former Representative Creever.
That's it. Great. The way it was phrased, it sounds.
It's still alive. It's like the start of a murder mystery.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Poor Barbara. Mm-hmm.
It was the dog.
Really?
What was the word?
You see another conforming change here. We'd already talked about this issue yesterday, actually. This is just a couple of places where the word owns hadn't been struck. We missed it on this time around. Remember, the idea there is that when you're talking about requiring relinquishment of firearms or information about firearms that the defendant has, in some situations it would also be information that somebody else has on behalf of the defendant, but they wouldn't own the firearm on behalf of the defendant, so that's why that word is struck there, as well as in a couple of other places, which you had already seen yesterday. So that's it for the final order. Now moving on to the emergency order. Remember, this is the ex parte order, not done in the presence of the defendant, typically. And I think the changes you'll see here are just the same as what we looked at now. I looked at just now with respect to the emergency order. Again, this here that you see on lines 9 to 10, again, moving the language around with respect to available information, just for clarity, to make sure the court's clear that this doesn't mean they have to reach out to try and find other information. This is only about information that is available to the court at that time. And to make clear here that the information includes type, number, and location of firearms. That was in the final order already, but I think it was just an oversight that it wasn't repeated here, the word number, I mean.
Sure. So, Eric, can you say more about, I know we had heard from people about their concern about ex parte. There are times that a judge won't do an ex parte hearing, right? And there are times that they will. Is that only when the law specifies, or is it related to safety?
I think, generally speaking, people have a right to be heard. So the court is inclined to have parties whose interests are being decided in front by a judge be represented, or at least they're, pro se. In one way or another, they're allowed to be present. And you have to be constitutionally if your rights are going to be adjudicated. There are some exceptions to that, and those are either set out by, that have been found over time, but typically are in statute. So like this, for example, where there are certain times when a civil commitment proceeding can be ex parte. There are times when property seizures can be ex parte. But usually, to conform with due process, you have a right to a hearing within a reasonable time afterward, and courts have kind of varied about how much time is reasonable, but 14 days definitely is, at least under the court decision. So, but it's set out in statute that the hearing will be ex parte, but you have a right to be there and be present since your interests are being affected within a certain amount of time afterward.
But is there sort of a standard of proof that's used for when to use an ex parte? Like, I guess I'm wondering if it's not in statute, and you said sometimes judges will decide, is it, this is related to something bad will happen if the defendant were in the room at that particular time, they would destroy evidence, they might hurt somebody.
I don't know of anything articulated that's okay. sort of a general rule as to when there can be ex parte hearings, but I do think that if you looked at them, yes, you would generally see that there's some kind of immediacy required for some reason, whether it's, think of the ERPO, for example, has an ex parte provision, immediate treatment, medical treatment sometimes can be ex parte, or this here, RFA, it's ours that if you look for some sort of connecting thread, it's some time-sensitive immediacy. I don't know that that's ever been, it may have been, but I'm not aware of any place that that's set down as the rule, but it does seem common.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And this law has been on the books quite a while, the RFA.
Yeah, quite some time.
Right. It's just, it seems like people keep raising ex parte, and it just seems like the better I understand it, the more I'm equipped to
answer. Well, we're dealing in an existing statutory scheme. It's been on the books for quite a while.
So you'll see the language on 11 to 14 is exactly the same language that you just looked at in the context of the emergency order. This is the same concept in the, that we just looked at in the final order. This is the same concept in the emergency order, which is providing defendant information about how firearms that are relinquished are stored and what the options are for storage and what the requirements are, particularly with respect to third-party storage. Same language as you just saw. Also here, another example of just repeating language that you already looked at in the final order context. This is the point about not requiring information about locks, location, safe, et cetera, if the defendant has voluntarily turned them over.
So real quick, just back to the question Barbara had. In Section 1104, subsection A1, which we don't have in the bill, it says, upon a finding that there is an immediate danger to further abuse. So there is an immediacy requirement for the ex parte.
Thank you.
We already saw this as well. This is the, as I pointed out, the language about informing the defendant about their storage options was struck here but moved up above. It's another example of striking the word owns from language about someone else holding firearms on behalf of the defendant. Section 4 is the new crime. No changes there. The new crime for a person being in possession of a firearm, whether they're subject to an emergency or final relief from abuse order. Now we're getting into the service section, which is next, and warrants. Again, no changes in here between what we looked at previously. This is talking about the return of service form, what the contents have to be in the return of service form that's brought back to the court after the order is served. You see there's a spelling correction, line 20, filed used to be healed. This is more about related to the contents. This is, and seeing the different colors, these weren't changed to the previous draft, they've been amendments that were made previously. Yeah, nothing there. So again, there's a reference. This is in connection with the service of the orders and the return of the service, the return of service to the court. There's some language about law enforcement officer and agency immunity. It means they can't be sued or prosecuted criminally for acts they take or omissions that are made when in good faith reliance on what the law requires in this subchapter. And you see that clarification is made on line 1, page 16. So it's not just actions that they take under that section of law. It's any sections in the subchapter, which all deals with the relief from abuse orders and the related issues. So when the officer relies on those provisions in good faith, then they can't be sued for something they might have done or not done. there's some minor language tweaks in these immunity provisions. Remember, that sort of this is an enumeration of some of the things that they can't be sued for. It uses the word including. You see on line two, including does not mean limited to. It's just these are some illustrative examples of what constitutes conduct that they can't be subject to lawsuit for. So some clarifying language there. They can't generally be sued for returning a seized or relinquished weapon if the person is not prohibited from owning or possessing under state or federal law. Also clarifying that they're immune from any damage caused while accessing or removing the firearm. So it's not just finding it, it's also removing it, taking it away. Now, you see subdivision B there is struck entirely. That's because that actually is repetitive. It just repeats language that already exists in the same firearm storage section that I was mentioning earlier, the one in Title 20. That language is already there. The reason it was there is because it was in the bill as originally introduced before all this new immunity language was added. So once all this new immunity language is added, this is no longer necessary. Previously, you'd struck some of these reporting requirements. They're gone. These definition requirements are not new, but they actually are moved in placement. They're moved to the end of this section on relief from abuse orders. Just seems to make more sense to have the terms defined afterward when you're presenting them.
So I was wondering, actually, if it made more sense for earlier in the process or earlier in the bill. And I guess a question we can ponder.
Where it was before, you mean?
Yeah. If we were to do that, does this have to become draft 9.1, or is that the kind of change since it's not really substantive? I'm just curious.
Yeah.
If we were going to move it back to the start of the
ordinarily section. You would, because it's going to require renumbering a bunch of the other sections.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But it doesn't matter where it is. I thought you had to move it here.
Yeah, I think I put that together with the impeding when we were still talking about the impeding.
Right.
Thought that got all that
smooth. Right.
But Eric, can you explain your thinking in terms of drafting the thing here? Just tell us more about why you think it flows better here, or.
I don't have a good opinion on that. That was just at the request.
I did not have a clear communication.
Oh, okay.
It's my fault.
Okay.
It's my fault that it moved here.
Okay.
I apologize,
sorry.
But I don't know that that's where it should.
Right. If you were putting it somewhere, our convention would be to put it in the beginning,
right.
Just because numerically, that's where it comes right. in the statutes.
That's what I was trying to get.
Right.
Yeah.
So, do you want to move it back?
Well, let's
All right.
We'll have to talk about that.
Okay. Section 7, you'll see, is new, and this is the language that I think was discussed in committee yesterday. It hadn't actually been in the bill yet, but Representative Hashim and I had worked on some language to, and this sort of is related to the removal of the criminal offense. Remember, there was the criminal offense of hindering, it's related to the hindering statute that made it a new crime for someone to not obey a law enforcement officer's order at the scene of the service of a domestic violence, an RFA order. So, since that's gone, the proposal to add here is that just to clarify that the subchapter is not going to in any way limit or affect the existing law enforcement officer authority that they have under existing law and procedure, including any lawful authority to control the movement of individuals at a scene in the interest of protecting safety. So whatever authority an officer has now to manage a scene, in fact, that's just one example. As you see the way it's phrased, nothing in this subchapter shall be construed to in any way limit or affect the authority of an officer under existing law procedure. So any authority is not limited by this subchapter, anything to do with the RFAs or the service or the return of service, any of that. So existing law stays as it is the clarification there.
Okay.
So, thank you. So if that's already existing law, why do we have to add it back in here?
I think it's one of those situations where it's probably not legally necessary, but sometimes it helps to highlight something. So I think I agree with you if your point is it legally necessary? No. This would be interpreted that way by a court anyway. But sometimes you choose, and against your policy choice, sometimes you choose to put something in law to highlight a point or to make something clear to a reader in a given place, because without it being expressly written there, a citizen who reads the law might or might not know that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Now, so the, everyone okay to move on to ERPOs, Extremist Protection Order? So, this is an easy one to explain. So, this section was struck entirely. You'll see that for a while, the two proposals that have been involved here, there were two things going on. I shouldn't say it's not struck entirely. There's one piece at the end we'll get to. But the two pieces related to adding household, family and household members to the list of folks who could petition for an Extremist Protection Order, that piece is gone. As is the language that the committee had discussed about if you were going to have family or household members permitted to file for an ERPO, then in the case of an emergency ERPO, they could only file it based on risk of harm to another person. Since you're striking ERPOs entirely, obviously you don't need that little subset of...
Right. And there's also the after hours. I mean, it was becoming... Okay.
Right. So the piece related to ERPOs that is still in here, you'll see, is Section 8, and that is the same language that was in the bill that was vetoed by the governor last year, and that is permitting healthcare providers to let law enforcement officers know when they think a person is a danger without violating federal medical record privacy law. So that has been unchanged since the bill has been introduced and is actually, as I say, unchanged from the bill that was vetoed last year. Conditions of release prior to trial stays the same, adding a provision that conditions of release include requiring the defendant not to possess firearms or other weapons. No changes to the reporting requirements or the effective date, which remains July 1st, 2020.
Eric, I couldn't find it myself. Can you just point me to the section where it highlights that the defendant can get their hearing within 14 days? Or
I think it's in the underlying, probably not in the bill in front of you.
1103?
1104, I think.
1104, okay. Yes. I was looking at 11.
So, yes. So actually, I was going to ask you to walk through the entire bill. Again.
Okay, good. I was going to ask for a section, so that might cover it.
Yeah, because we've been focusing on the changes from draft to draft, and I think it would be helpful to just walk through the entire bill. And so some of the answers that folks are thinking, I think, would come up in the walkthrough.
So we're going to walk through the clean copy?
Yeah, I was going to say we should probably walk through the clean copy.
Which we're not. We don't have it, right? It's still the
Cooper's,
I think, copy.
Right.
Mm-hmm. This might be a little less confusing without diverting to stuff that's crossed out.
Yeah, I think that
could bring up more questions. Of, I don't remember why that was here.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Do we know when that was?
I think they were 2011-ish.
Okay. So we have the joint assembly, which should be quick because there's no contest. It's at 10:30, or what they call it before, like 10:15, but I think it should be quick. So if we can come back here, I don't know, 11:15, 11:30, I mean, if we don't get off the floor until 11:45, then and finally come back and regroup, but let's try to come back here and do the walkthrough.
Yeah, I mean, there's two candidates and two positions, so
right,
there shouldn't be too much debate.
But don't we still have to have people be the vote counters and everything?
Yeah. Probably, but hopefully they can do one. And
one ballot.
A quick question. On this 14-day, I just was scanning through 1104, and I don't see that it Oh, wait, I just voted that. Yeah, it's 1104B. 14 days from the day. Sorry, no question. This wasn't for you.
Sure.
Okay. So we're going to take a pause at 6:10.
Do you want me to shoot you an email when it's ready for, or you just want to plan on a certain time, just after the joint assembly?
Yeah, let's try to get back to yours as soon as possible after the floor.
Okay.
Yeah.
But right after the floor, then it'll benefit.
Yeah,
just
trying to get back, yeah.
The bill.
And then you need Eric to, or
you
can
No, I think we just have to decide what
we want
to do with this now.
Okay, great. So, 13 years to
579, 580.
Right, right.
Yeah, well, that was one of the, there was a few things I just wanted to see where the speed was. So we're looking at 579 and 580. There's a few things I just wanted to try to get a bit of temperature check, so to speak, of the committee. One is combining them into one, and I'll let Eric decide whatever is easiest, so that we'll either have just 580 or 579 next time when we look at it. Looking at what is currently 579, I'm going to ask Eric to put back in there the transitional position provisions based on our conversation that we had, whatever that was last week. So, and then on 580, I'm
just
sorry,
a quick explanation what that transitional piece was.
The point of transitional piece is to say that if for those crimes that haven't been categorized in law by, it would be July 1st of 2021, that this is how they'll be treated within the context of the whole scheme. The idea is right now the Sentencing Commission is getting through the rest of the crimes and recommending where we categorize them. And presumably, we'll take that up at the beginning of next biennium, or whoever's in this room will take it up in the next biennium. And it essentially gives a deadline that you need to get this done by next session. Or this transitional period will, or transition scheme or schematic will go into place. So that's the concept. So going to 579, I think there's really mainly one issue, and what I'm going to propose, and I think I have Tom on board with this, is the felony threshold, and this would be
2,000.
Go back 100.
Oh, I thought
that was 3,000. It was yesterday.
It was 3,000.
Double.
Do I hear 2,500?
Yeah. No. Don't,
I just had to give my one last little.
Don't encourage them.
We could pay them when they come to ground.
So $3,000 will be the threshold that will take you into a Class E felony, which is 3 years, and I still would just have the $100,000 value would stay the same for the level for a Class D felony. So that's the suggestion I'm going to make there, and I think that's it. It's the combination, putting back the transition, and changing that felony threshold.
So moved.
So, I mean, are there...
Oh, there's not enough people.
Any big issues with that? I mean, we're not voting or anything now, but I just, before I instruct Eric, if there's any more...
Talk to us.
Are you going to combine them? Yeah.
Can you just remind me again about the rationale that we had for making it 3,000? Was it to match up with the other states?
It was to not get too far ahead of the other states.
Right.
Because the highest the other state is 2,500. So 3,000... Because other states are considering raising,
but we're always
the trail
blazers. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. It's not much of a trail blazer. 10,000 would have been really.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Lynn, can you remind me how many is draft 1.1 the last revision we've seen?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So can you say the I'm sorry, could you say the are you changing the, so the version I'm looking at has the felony structure class A 500,000, B 2,500,000, C, so I'm just trying to square that with what you said about.
Where are you, which bill? 580?
Yes, oh, yes, sorry, I apologize.
Which bill are you on?
It's why it's good to combine.
I was just looking at the wrong.
That's the whole thing.
Wrong bill.
Going back,
okay.
Back and forth from bill to bill. Yeah. Which one are you looking at now?
Well, now I'm looking at the right bill.
Yeah, 579.
Yeah.
Okay. No, that's why.
Yeah, it would be helpful to see.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
It would be helpful to update that chart and just
right.
Which chart that says what goes up and what goes down?
I ran for poultry.
Just this chart that buckets all the crimes in a table form. Yeah. When we started, just to be able to look at it more coherently, that would help me. Struggling to process things coherently.
Right. I will get the chart for the pepper. I might even ask Pepper, who the first member of the United States.
Yeah.
The Secretary of Defense of Portion. So.
Hi, pal.
Yes, sir.
Can we just go and get these combined and then discuss it, so then it's
I was just asking questions to see what I should ask.
Because that's the goal, is to have one bill.
We've never looked at them separately.
One bill, and I'm going to get this chart that is in the recommendations and updated what we've changed.
Yes,
bless you. So we'll have that information that inform our discussion.
And I'm hoping that we can vote that one out really next week. I think that hangs out over controversial, but I will make sure that's what can happen.
You have a lot of pressure.
No. there's that. I am starting to feel a crossover crunch. Sometimes
it's not written out
13.
Somewhere.
Yeah, so it's funny, it's that week after we come back, which is tricky. I don't know, I kind of like it before town meeting, because we can wait to leave.
What day is the 13th?
Just a meal.
Friday.
Our notes from the
board. I'm waiting to get back to the Attorney General's office on the possession of child abuse materials, because I'd really like to get that out and tell people to leave, hopefully. So if we get the detectives back in as well, that'd be great.
Oh, yeah.
Are we going to spend more time on the Act 215 stuff?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know.
Interestingly enough, at judicial retention last night, the female lawyer that was in here last night, late, testified down there.
She came back too when we were meeting.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
The
rest
of the room, but.
Well, she said, since the three of you are here, can I talk to you? And basically, we said, look, we have Matt for, Matt said, like, this is my last day. Mm-hmm. So they dismissed him. And I said, we've got to get this appropriations memo done, and then I have to leave. Mm-hmm. And Coach was smart and just, like, kept focused this way, so they reluctantly left. But then somebody else came in who had concerns, who was just a citizen, and saying, like, I've asked to testify, I don't know why I can't. I'm like, you know what, I don't know what's happening in the other committees, and we don't have possession, we have a narrow focus.
I don't understand. I don't think they really understand what that means.
I mean,
I have a possession, and just have looked at it really narrow. a few paragraphs, basically.
I do think it would. Tom and I were thinking the same thing. I think last night we actually have an environmental court judge up for retention, and we could have one of the two judges testify briefly just to understand.
They generally don't do that. That's really Judge Grierson's job.
Yeah, that would be fine.
Maybe we could ask.
Yeah.
If we could take more
testimony,
we could ask. But,
Because I did talk to him last night about the bill a little bit. The judge.
I just feel like I need more information than what we got, frankly, to weigh in on it. And so I can seek that information on my own.
I can ask the judge if that's appropriate.
We didn't really have any time to weigh in on anything on that, did we? We really didn't have time to weigh in on anything on that. I mean,
we haven't discussed it.
I just feel like I need more information, but I can, if I'm an outlier in that, I can seek it on my own.
I don't think you're an outlier needing information. I think it's the process. Generally, individual judges, and the environmental court's a little different because it's a dedicated court with two dedicated judges.
Right.
But generally, Judge Grierson will pull judges, he'll talk to us and talk to us, sort of like with Pepper. We often don't see individual state's attorneys. We might, but I feel like I need to pose that question to Grierson.
Because he didn't have I asked him about the bill, and first thing he said, I've got no opinion on the policy.
But what he
did talk about was the way the system used to be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And some issues with the way that the system used to be, that there was some cases that ended up in two courts, and then in the end, both courts came up with different decisions, so then they had to start all the way over again. And I'm not saying this isn't exactly what he said, but the way I took what he said is that there's some similarities going to with this new policy that goes back to the way it used to be.
And
he kind of alluded to that he has some concerns that something like that might happen again.
One person that the citizen that talked to us said in Montpelier, a lot of people got elected to the city council and are pushing their projects, and things are sort of taken away from citizens, and he was worried that the state board would be very political. It's like, and I was like, this is out of my
The town appeals will still, I mean, there's certain, if you look at the chart that they shared, there's a lot more detail there about the natural resources board. Actually, will there some appeals, but like a town permit appeal would still go to environmental court, which
right.
is like a really rigorous process. So that's not, except for some very minimal, I mean, I think they can hear like really minimal appeals.
But didn't downtowns get exempt or something from the appeals?
From Act 250.
That was the issue. But I don't know which committee. I mean, it'd be nice to say, like, if it got so chopped up that every committee just looked at a little bit, but nobody's looked at the whole, I'm assuming they did.
Just spends a lot of time.
Like a year and a half.
Yeah.
There was the
beforehand. It would be great if they kind of gave us a FAQ or something, I don't know, or if we're supposed to tell people to contact them if they have concerns.
The other thing is to contact who?
Natural resources.
You know, often people don't like the outcome.
Right.
They come back and there is another body.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But I know this is supposed to be on the floor next week.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what the, I think the angry attorney was like, I'm going to start fighting it on the Senate side.
Right.
And like, that's probably a good approach.
You know, that's what she was saying.
Huh? This is probably a good approach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that's
right.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, at this
like,
point,
okay, you're not.
We're just about done with it over here.
Right.
I do just, I mean, I'll dig into the bill and maybe come up with some more specific questions, but I do just feel like I want to understand the implications more of which appeals now go to the board, which appeals go to the Supreme Court, mm-hmm. and how the nature of those reviews might change.
Right. Like,
it seems significant.
Right.
Because we went through that at exit one, it was
lengthy. I think Marjorie was, yeah.
You know, and it really, it's good to have clarity about the process, and I think that the chart that she put together helped to do that, but that's not necessarily within our purview. But a better understanding of the process, you know, is always good.
And I mean, I felt like the overall theme that we were hearing from the few voices yesterday was somehow that the people's voice is taken out of the process, and so I don't feel like I could.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because I think many times when you talk to some people, say that their voices are taken out of the process right now, and that the environmental court is really lawyered up.
Yeah.
Other people,
right. Mm. Do you think the lawyers would like it then? Because it's like more.
Some people say the lawyers do like the current system.
Right, yeah. I don't know.
So,
right.
Yeah.
Because we will definitely have, if that's the buzz, like constituents will definitely ask that, and it'd be nice to, as Linda said, like know what we're talking about.
Yeah. Anyway, okay. But that was pretty intense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it didn't stop.
I know. And when she came back, it
turned
sort of
my back on somebody. I mean, I really I was trying to end the conversation literally to talk to you guys.
We had a hard time with her. She was definitely.
Yeah.
Not as in our face, but it was. She was in your public.
She was an interesting witness.
She was aggressive.
Yeah.
A little
put
aggressive.
It mildly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Probably a reasonable defense attorney.
Yeah, they all are. All attorneys.
Well, she's the best.
So, all right, so I guess we're now in the